That sets approach to the feedstock transition, including hydrogen. The first point I wish to make, it's not for nothing that it's a Brightlands co-production, this presentation. We are doing this from a chemical integrated site. Hydrogen for us is a very important product. Hydrogen is a feedstock product. We make fertilizers and other products with hydrogen. When the public debate is about hydrogen, it's often about energy and fuels. It's obvious because oil for us is also a fuel, but oil at Brightlands and in Chemelot is not a fuel, but is a feedstock. And I will get back to that later. What I wish to do in this short presentation is look at our approach and how do we go about feedstock transition and particularly then hydrogen. So oil is a feedstock, hydrogen is a feedstock. Electricity is known as fuel or as energy. Electricity is probably not a feedstock if you look at mass balance, but electricity is important to make better molecules. The core of electrolysis is to add electrolysis to water and you get hydrogen. So whether electricity is a feedstock is probably a strong word, but we look at the other applications than energy. What is important in our program, and I'm leading the Brightside team, is to demonstrate and to educate. And let's think about demonstrate. There are so many technologies known where you can work with hydrogen and new forms of hydrogen, but few, very few, are really up to industrial scale. Scaling up is a very, very big issue for us. And the question is, how to do that, how to get there. We know from electrolysis that there is ambition to have several gigawatts of electrolysis positioned in the Netherlands. The largest electrolyzers are just in the megawatt scale and not in the gigawatt scale. So despite that the technology is there, even for electrolysis, and despite that I did it when I was a kid at school, technologies are known. But to demonstrate that it's possible in an industrial setting, so also not at a university or an institute lab, but in an industrial setting, is the big thing which we are after. And then, of course, it's also about education. We represent the chemical industry. Chemical industry is characterized by tremendous optimization. We have created a super efficient oil and gas system, but we need to go from optimization to innovation again. It requires new people, new engineers, new co-workers, and new mindset. So that is not for nothing that we say our mission is to demonstrate and to educate in this respect. And then, yeah, let's look at what is then this integrated site. And when we look at the other speakers, which will be announced after me, they will focus on topics which are relevant for an integrated site. I want to get back to electrolysis because I made a statement on electrolysis. We need more than that. There's a beauty on electrolysis. The beauty is that it has a selectivity of basically one. You turn water into hydrogen. And okay, then there is oxygen as well. Oxygen has hardly value, despite, of course, today in the COVID situation where we need oxygen in places like India, etc. But basically, electrolysis is a process with a selectivity of one, it's creating hydrogen. When we look at numerous other technologies, you find much more complex selectivity when you start reacting and create hydrogen as one of the products. So it was announced already that we talk about biomass gasification, we will talk about other electrification processes like plasma activated work. And there is not a selectivity of one. It's so important that we work out of integrated sites. And this is a very interesting integrated sites because there are three things coming together. There is an industrial site where we can really test and work in industrial conditions. There's a campus, the Brightland campus. And the campus is the place where knowledge centers, but also startups and scale-ups can work together. And then we have Organizations like BrightSight, but it's not just BrightSight, there are also other organizations from the knowledge infrastructure, University of Maastricht, IBM and others, working together. But the things we invent, we at BrightSight invent, and later in this presentation, there will be a presentation on plasma activation. At a certain point, we need to hand over, it needs to be handed over to enterprise, to a scale-up, or to one of the large site users. By working together, we hope to guarantee the fastest valorization, the fastest use of technology in real life. I think that makes Gemalot so important that it also make me change from a national job. I've been in the management team of TNO before, to Gemalot and lead BrightSight at the Gemalot campus. If you go, then what does an ecosystem, what is it? When I was at the BrightSight campus, and I would invite people on the in this webinar to visit the campus and to go to building one, that's the old building which is there, and there is a central laboratory is stated in nice gold painted letters above the main entrance. And that is something from the past decades. It was a central lab creating that site, organizing all the interactions, optimizing the complete site with the energy and mass material flows between the various factories. I've put it here, the word Verbund site 1.0. Verbund sites, optimized sites, where there was one owner creating, and it are about 65 factories, which you can find today at Gemalot, optimized together. And in terms of CO2, we can be proud on Gemalot because we believe that 10 to 15% lower CO2 emission is apparent at Gemalot compared to when all these 60 factories would have been working not connected to each other in a system. So that Verbund site has a role, and it was created by one owner, and the owner was DSM. It's not meant as negative, but it's a closed innovation model, and that was how it was. And I've been working at Philips, and you see at the Philips NotLab in Eindhoven, basically the same history. We have learned to go to open innovation, externally focused, collaborative innovation, and working with others, but always still there's a dominant player who wants to optimize their own value chain. I see companies like Shell, for instance, working with a number of startups and scale-ups and improving the portfolio. And when it's positive, then they buy that company and then it becomes part of Shell. I think that's an interesting, very important next step. When we look at what happened both at the two campuses I'm referring to, both to Eindhoven for high tech, as well as to DSM, Geleen, Gemalot, then we get further to the right-hand side. Probably what is not completely true is that all actors at Gemalot have the same size. All the circles have the same diameter. Some circles are bigger and larger than others, but they all depend on each other. And they all also need newcomers and have new interactions. And that's an ecosystem-centric cross-organizational innovation system. And that is what I call Verbund site 2.0. That is what we need to make work. And that is also the environment in which hydrogen needs to flourish. There will be players who have a certain step in hydrogen to create it. There need to be other people who take it. People who help with installations, with equipment, and et cetera. And it will happen in an ecosystem-centric cross-organizational innovation. And that is why the campus is so important. That is why it's so important that the industrial players are very close to us, and that there are knowledge centers and knowledge activities like BrightSight and others at the campus. Innovation networks. As such, innovation and hydrogen go closely together. And you see that also in the public debate. Hydrogen is on top of the political agenda in the Netherlands as well as in Europe. It's a public topic. We can only do this with public-private partnership. In the end, products can only be made, plastics can only be made, and fertilizers can only be made by companies, and they compete in the market. We have in our system built in what we call the full value chain from invention, concept validation, etc., to market expansion. You can also refer to the TRL scales, from low TRL to high TRL. And what we see with hydrogen, but also with other technologies, that both TRL 1 and 9 are relevant. The R, as I said, I refer to my own electrolysis at my high school. The R technologies, which are decades old, there will be an example also later in this conference on plasma, where we find technologies invented, let's say, at the Second World War time. So they exist, they are TRL 9. We still need inventions. We need to go back. We need to think about fundamental research and other research. For hydrogen, it's important, not only for electrolysis, but particularly also for all the other ways to generate hydrogen, where we look at that same scaling up. And to do that, you need to do that with parties who understand the various phases and let them work together and have overlap. Brightside is there to scale up. I think that is the challenge which we all have. And I put it here, the cover of a book, which is probably 10 years old in the meantime. Probably some of you have heard about Mariana Mazzucato. She's a professor in the United Kingdom, and she's promoting the entrepreneurial state, or also basically also state intervention, where market does not flourish and it does not come automatic. In this case, the generation of hydrogen in the various ways will not come automatic. The business cases do not come to good results yet. We know that in Holland, things like Groeifonds, but also the Green Deal and other things are really necessary to boost. The government needs to help with infrastructure. The government needs to help with covering a period of not yet being profitable. So the entrepreneurial state is a big issue. And we are also happy that in our ecosystem-centric innovation, I put it here in the logo of the province of Limburg, but I could also, they are supporting, but also economic affairs, also European Union and others. We need to do it together. We need to understand each other's role, and we need to hand over, and we need to build that in together. For hydrogen, to make hydrogen a real success, this is essential. Otherwise, we will not get there. By the way, hydrogen needs to become successful, otherwise we will fail in our climate mission. So I think this setup, this is our approach for hydrogen working together. By the way, none of these organizations mentioned here are exclusive. The universities, there are many universities to work with, also in our hydrogen campaigns. Proton, Maastricht University, Proton Partners, which we have found together with Maastricht. TNO, of course, SciTech is representing the site users and the companies. Now let's take some numbers and have another view on the picture. I want to come back once more on the fact that this is about, that my pitch is about the feedstock transition. If you are in Rotterdam Harbor and you see these big oil tankers coming in, then realize that 70%, 75% of what is coming in into Rotterdam is going into fuels. And it's not for nothing that the energy transition is called the energy transition. And there is nothing wrong with that, because when you cover the fuel consumption and you make the fuel consumption green, then we serve the planet, we serve the climate. When we look at Gemelot, oh, sorry, it's 90%. Sorry, I apologize. It's 90%, which is taken for fuels. It's 75% at Gemelot, which is used for material, and only 25% for fuels. So this balance, 90% at the Netherlands level of oil coming in into Rotterdam is used for fuels, is only 25% for fuels at Gemelot. And that is why we make such a strong point. It is now time, after, let's say, 3-4 years of working on the fuel transition, that we work on the feedstock transition. And that will do a lot. And you see here two pictures of Gemelot. Basically, it was on one of the earlier slides as well. We have the nitrogen and the carbon value chains. And they are fed with electric energy, methane and naphtha, fossil sourced. And when you have the incoming flows green, then basically largely the whole system becomes green, and also all the value chains behind it. Now, Hydrogen has two roles, and the next speaker will say a lot about that, on what is the role of hydrogen in Gemalot. In this picture, I basically give just one hint on the issue. Hydrogen can be part, particularly green hydrogen, to help making the inflow into Gemalot green. So that is, of course, a very important role. And secondly, we will also generate hydrogen. There will be hydrogen made in the processes as one of the products. And also, by being created at Gemalot, also further work on green products. An integrated site, integrated chemical site, is for this the way to go. When we dive deeper on what is our approach, then we need to, I wish to, of course, and then we get green carbon. And I wish to explain this picture. If you want to make Gemalot green, and I get back to hydrogen after this, there are basically six lines where we work on, and all six have to do with nitrogen, with hydrogen. That's why I want to explain this picture. Of course, electrification. And you know, electrification from electrolysis is electrification and other processes. We need to make Gemalot circular and work on different feedstocks. Now, it was already mentioned that also on the feedstock transition and on bio-based biogasification, you get into hydrogen. Process innovation, we know that from home. Saving energy, doing better insulation is the best thing you can do. That are essential pillars to make Gemalot clean. We can only do that in a safe and societal acceptable innovation. But realize, when you introduce new technologies, you get new risks and you get new issues and you get new logistical flows and you get another way that the environment and the population around us needs to deal with the chemical side. So line four is very important to look at that. And line five is where I wish to point that, and which will also be a source for the next presentation after me. We need to think in transition scenarios, and the transition scenarios needs to be rational. We need to work from the system approach. Now, that is all necessary for hydrogen. And last but not least is number six, which is the foundation, is education and people. Now, when we look at hydrogen, then you see all the colors of hydrogen as we know them flying in. And we work at Gemalot with all those colors. On electrification, electrolysis is what we call green hydrogen. At the moment, there is not an electrification program at Gemalot, but of course, electrolysis will be an important way to create green hydrogen, and is from that point of view important. Where we work on is in the turquoise color. That will be one of the speakers after me. This turquoise color, we basically mean it's hydrogen which is created without CO2 in the equation. So we create hydrogen out of other molecules, particularly methane, without creating CO2. That is, according to the definition, not green hydrogen, because green hydrogen is made out of water by electrolysis, but it's clean hydrogen. Then in circular, there will be presentations also on hydrogen where there is no fossil fuel used, and there's no fossil CO2 in the equation. I also gave that the same color green. Where we are dealing with, of course, in Gemalot, is a lot of gray hydrogen. And gray hydrogen is created with gray CO2. And with gray CO2, there are options to work with in order to make that hydrogen, and that, again, an acceptable product. One of the big issues is, of course, CCS. Get it under the North Sea in the new projects, as Portos has recently been announced, but also carbon capture and utilization is very important on the integrated site. Can we reuse the CO2 which is coming available by creating hydrogen out of the fossil sources? Can we do better things with it? So that's also in line three, where we pay attention to it. And of course, when you do CCS, gray turns into blue. But hydrogen is in white, mentioned in line 5, 4 and 6, because it is so very important that we accelerate the transition by providing analysis methods and models, all fact-based and science-based. Gemalot, I introduced Gemalot to you as Verbund site 2.0, And that is a system. It is a system existing out of 65 factories. In these 65 factories, we find all colors of hydrogen back. These factories as such are probably also systems, but also Gemmelot is part of a larger system in the Netherlands and in Europe, or the ARA cluster. Working on fact-based, science-based modeling is very, very important. And I hope that in the next parts of this conference, you get confidence that this is what we do, and this is how we also wish to position hydrogen and grow hydrogen to the role it deserves. So far, my presentation.